I'm Fred. The meaning of this video is not only to repair this thing we're going to repair, but also to show you how to troubleshoot and how to make rather small repairs like this. This is a good way to start and to practice because it's all not too complicated for the electronics. If I take a spectrum analyzer and we go through that and you don't have much experience in this sort of things repairing, then it will be hard and you easily make it worse. You make it bad, but in this case it's just a simple battery charger that is used to warm a jacket. And it has some problems, like I will tell you after this. Hi folks, when I came home yesterday from my first Christmas day eating with my parents and my brothers, I smelled some burning, something burning. I went to there on my motorbike and I thought it was cold, so I have a Dainese inner jacket for my motor jacket that is heated, but the batteries were not full, so I wanted to charge it. But it was not as cold as I thought, so I forgot all about the jacket and I forgot to pull it out of the mains connection. And that was a fault. This is not some Chinese cheap crap jacket or so. This Dainese is a very expensive brand of motor things like motorcycle jackets and trousers, but also other sports like skiing. And this jacket was, if I remember well, over 500 euros. I used to work in that brand, so I didn't buy it. I got it from them to test it because I rode at that time my motorbike every day. And it always served me well, but yesterday I was coming back and then I just heard that, I smelled that that smell like Lynyrd Skynyrd sings in a song. And then I took the sleeves of the jacket where this is the control panel in it, and I noticed some little dark stain, and it turned out to be it was burned there. I touched it with my finger and I burned my finger, and it was just glowing orange and it was just starting to get on fire, or at least it could be going on fire, or the fabric that is mounted around it. So that was a bit of a shock because my dog was still at home. I don't want her to and my house to burn down. So I opened it to see what was wrong with it, and I will show you. This is the problem I noticed right away, and it's just under the black stain in the cover. This is a blown up tantalum capacitor. Now the problem is with those things is that they are they can live very long, but they have a problem with overvoltage. So my first guess was there must be something wrong with the power supply from this. So I took the power supply apart and I will show you what's inside of there. So this is the power supply. The thing I saw right away was, and I don't know if you can see it very well on video. Maybe if I, wrong side, if I flip it a bit, I think you can see it. The problem there is this one looks very crusty. It's hard to see on camera probably, but more important, I saw some black here on the coil. And then when I looked behind the coil, I see a lot of black. So first thing I did was measuring the output of this power supply, and that was around 22 volts. And the specs on the thing say it will give 13.8 volt. So this is a rather high voltage that's coming out, or there must be something wrong. So first the thing I normally do is measure on the thing, but in this case it will be a bit hard because this is the power connection to get into the mains, so I have to mount some wires to it. But that has not much use if we look to this. First thing I have to do is to take those out and check them, and then if there's more wrong, then we have to check the data sheet of this PWM controller and look if it is a known one, and then try to test it. If I look to the bottom of this thing, the first thing I notice are these solder blobs. This is not a good way to solder things. And if you look at top side of it, for this one, zooming is not my strongest point. And then you see here a very big blob of solder. So I don't know what they were thinking when they were soldering it, but it sure was not a nice job. So I will first take it apart. So I warmed up my soldering and desoldering iron, and but first thing is more important. Normally I have it now on video, so then it's tempting not to do it, but it is best to make pictures and make drawings of things you're going to take apart. Of it, first thing I will do is remove the inductor. Inductors are easy to test. Inductors like this, that is, and they are easy to repair if the core is still okay. And this is not a very hefty power supply. If you can see it, it looks worse as it is. I don't think the core is really damaged. It is just the wax that is on it that is burnt, and the thing that was bungling there is not a wire. It's just some hot snot used to make it stuck against something. You see the black goo side with this light, and that will have to be cleaned because the stuff is conducting. But in this case, it could be the coil is just got very hot and the wax was soft, the glue was melting. In this case I think it's wax, and that dripped on the PCB, because like you see, it is not in the PCB burnt, it was just on top of it. So that is nice, that saves us some work. The second thing will be the transistor or MOSFET or whatever it is. I have to look that up. Probably it is a MOSFET. So we have it loose here, and here we see a whole burnt black side, but that does not say everything because it can be now if you, I don't know if you can see it on camera. Yeah, if you look, you see it. There's a bump on it. So that was, I'm very sure it was not there when they made it. At least I hope it was not there. I can imagine it was there. Because this one is dead. The holy smoke escaped, I'm afraid. So, we will look up the data sheet and then examine the transistor, because I'm always curious what is inside. So now let's pretend we don't know if this transistor is okay. I've looked up the data sheet and it is a PNP transistor. So the pinout, it is also important to know, is ECB. It's always 1, 2, 3. So this is the emmer and this is the base. So this is the collector. It is often this is not a standard layout. It is a very much used layout, but you can find other ways, other ones. So always look up the data sheets. And the collector, if you don't know, the collector is almost always the mid one, just by the way they are built. To check them, I take my meter, my multimeter, then it should only conduct if you make the base negative and then measure the base emitter and base collector diodes. So in this way you should hear a beep to the one side and like this a beep to the other side, and then you can switch them around and test it for sure. And in this case it's all open circuit, so the base is not connected anymore to the transistor. So this one is surely dead. I can show you my transistor testers. I think I will make another video of that and show you all the ways to test the transistor. But this one is the easiest one with your multimeter. And 9 of the 10 times if you do it like that, it's okay. But transistors can have other failure modes, other kinds of shorts, but also more electronic things like not amplifying anymore, of amplifying or not. But those situations are rare. So we knew this one is dead, but now we are for sure. So now we test the inductor to be sure. You can do that with a multimeter just to hear, to see if there's no short between them. You can also use an LCR meter. And in that case, you know one thing, it gives 122 microhenries. I will write that down for future use, may it be needed. And then, like usual, I'm lost my pen. It's 2.5 microhenry, and more important, it has a Q of 7.69. Better measure always conductors in a higher frequency like this. This is 10 kilohertz because the power supplies operate on higher higher frequencies. In this, for now, I know the transistor is of the transformer is not open. Now I take an extra lead and I short that inside, and now you see that the Q is dropped from 34 to 4. So that will tell us that this conductor is probably not short, because if it was already short, the I have a video about it, testing transistors, if you want, of pressing switch or power supply transformer. So if you want to know that, look at that video. But in a normal healthy inductor, if I did what I did just now, then the inductance should drop. If it's not dropping, that means there is already one shorter turn somewhere on the transformer, in this case in the inductor. And in that case we know that it is not good. So this coil will be good. So now we knew that is right. We have here 4 diodes. We can sometimes test them in circuit, but sometimes it only is possible outside the circuit because there is a transformer over it. I take the diode tester. And if I put it over here, I should read 0.6, around 0.6 volts for normal diodes, like you see here. If I do it the other way, I should measure nothing. In this case, I measure some things, and that is the inductor that is behind it. Most important thing I'm checking right now for this is if the one is short. And in this case they all show a diode drop in one direction, so I know that there is no diode open, no diode shorted, probably also not open, but you have to draw it to really look the way the currents are flowing, what is connected to it. I think this thing is a fuse. or a capacitor. It doesn't look like a capacitor. Here's still another diode, and that is also showing a voltage drop, so that could be right. I have here some resistors, and one of them looks a little bit cooked, but not too bad. It will probably, sometimes you can measure it in circuit. In circuits like this that are so small and that have just only a small a transformer, it is most easiest to just remove the PCB. It's coming loose. The transformer is also a part that can die, of course. Like in this case, there was a lot of current on the in the circuit. So we will do a quick test there too, because if the transistor is dead, then there's not much sense to go on with this. It is a 16 millihenry. Now that's okay. That could be right. And you can do the same test with the shorting, like I did with the transformer. And then test it, but first look at the rest. If this is not open, it just doesn't look cooked or so. It is 3 henries at 120 hertz, and it is working at 50 hertz. So that and that could be a good value, and together with the resistance we measured, I think this is transformer is good. To check it, the most easy way is, but I've made a video, like I said, on that, is to put a signal generator on it and the scope on the other side. If it's dead, then you see also kinds of distortions, like a shorted coil. And the other test is to short it, like I did with the small one. But for this moment, I assume it is okay. Then we can do the last check for the diode that was here. That's parallel to a cap, probably. Now we're in the middle of things like that. Let's remove that one too. That takes it out of the equation. It is enough to lose it on one side. And does not influence anything anymore. So let's open. And now we have all the parts. There is one thing that is always a thing to look out for. One of those things can be a Zener diode, just to limit it. And this will be a TF431 or something like that. I don't know what it is. ACB, it is a transistor of some kind. The number is hard to read, but we can do a test like we did. In this case, it was a very expensive jacket, so it is makes sense to repair it, but it's just a simple power supply. It is more easy to replace it. It's not that it's just a 12 volts power supply. Probably maybe some current limiting, but I don't think so, because the IC on the controller plate is already a charging device, charging IC. This is the base, and let's short that way, or there is a resistor. And if it is an NPN, then is it 0.6, and that is 0.05. It looks like that one is shorted too, from the base to the emitter, or just that. 0.5 ohms, that is another one thing for sure. Oh, yeah, it can be. It has two sulfur. black goo that is on the end of the resistor. I will test it with a 4-wire measurement. I have to take the gear for that. Yeah, I've checked it. I don't know if I can show you the meter without dropping everything, but I measured it with a 4x probe on a bench meter that is here on my bench. It's a 7.5-digit meter. Not that I needed it for this, but that is the one that is closest by. And it, if I look under the microscope, it's or better light. It is 3.3 silver, and it measures 0.33 ohms. So this is a shunt, and the value I measure is correct. So this resistor is okay, and you can place it back. It's always the best thing to do is place the components you removed back in the PCB, so you don't lose them or forgot what their location was. And sometimes you think, oh, that is easy because it I knew it was there. But in bigger PCBs, also you see here there are a lot of holes not used. And if you in 2 or 3 days want to replace it back, then you can have should it be in this hole or in that hole, something like that. So it's better not to leave it dangling around. And this one, I think it is parallel to the output. This is on the minus, and this is on the going from here to there. Yes, this is over the output, and then in the opposite direction. So this will be some kind of protection, some zero. So can look up the data sheet. As I always use the same transformer to do that sort of things. Yeah, the LED, I don't know in what condition it is, but it is something for later. It is not short, that is the most important. The diodes are also not short. The next thing to check then is the capacitor, because if they go short, they take out the transistor too. In this case, this power supply went wrong. It gave 22 volts on the other, and that killed the tantalum on the input there. This cap is 415 microhenries with a low D, so this is still okay. And if I measure the ESR for the ESR aficionados, it is always handy for quick checks if you want. And this one has an ESR of 0.045 volts, so no matter what kind of table you are looking for, this one is just good. And capacity is also in the ballpark, so no problems there. And now I'm gonna replace it. And it was with the zero there. I often fold the legs a bit so it stays on its place more easy. Otherwise, you can put it in a 90 degrees angle and then solder the part in. That makes it also easier. And here we have a damaged pad, or damaged pad, we miss a pad. What I do in this case is I fold the pin to the trace, and I scraped a little bit of the trace off. And now you can see it. Follow the camera. A long way from home. Where it was, here it is. This one here. I fold it a little bit back, and then I'm gonna solder it on the track. And there's not much stress, mechanical stress on this point. But a tap is heavy, and if you toss it around a lot, then the heavy components can break loose in this way. So it's better to or just put some hot snot on the capacitor, or make a longer connection by using some piece of wire and making that longer, but it's not necessary for now. Now, so I found a replacement transistor. It's not really the same for specs, but it will do just to test this, and if all works, then I order the right one, because the one inside is a 3 amps. This is only a 1.5 amps at 60 volts. And it should only deliver something like 700 milliamps. But that is if you cool the transistors, and this one is not cooled. So, but just for testing, it will do. The transistor, and not in the way that I placed it. Yes, I should place it in this way. Just look at my picture. That one is on, yes, it was mounted correct. And the pin layout is the same, and I did a quick test with the diode tester to see if it is not broken, and it wasn't. And it's all soldered straight up. And then the only thing we left it is this LED and the transformer. Oh, my soldering iron is in power down mode, so I can't forget to shut it down. I did some visual inspection also. And it turns out this capacitor, one of the legs is the trace is burned away on that side, so I have to patch that. I will show you how I can do that in a rather easy way. I always, when I cut off legs of components, I collect the cut off pins, because they're great for making this kind of patches. If there's no space, what I then often do is I first form it in the right angle, and then I take a hammer and I make it flat, like a trace becomes wider and flatter, and then I solder it on the PCB, and it looks like a trace again. If it doesn't have to be, it only if it isn't just for quick and simple repair. Otherwise, I would make a whole new trace for this. And the legs are on its own also rather long. So maybe I can do something now. What I do is, in this case, it's a V-formed shape between two traces. I bend this into a V, and then I open the end a little bit with it, so the pin can go through it. So fold it over. Okay, so now holds. Put it straight up, because I don't want to short it to another area. It's okay, and then I can connect it, and then the V-shape thing at the end makes sort of a solder pad. This is a single-sided PCB. If you have a double-sided PCB, things become more complicated, because then you have to check if the VR is still okay, and also not the core in two parts. Okay. This is a strange design. Those two traces that are here, the trace here and the trace there, they are the same, they both come to the capacitor, but they're not connected there. I would have made that one big plane. And probably some auto routing thing or so, I don't know. I'm not a PCB designer, I'm a PCB repairer. Sometimes rebuilder, but I don't like making PCBs. I like designing stuff, but not the PCB part of it. That's why I built a lot of stuff just freehand with some milling or dead bug and copperclad. That's my radio background, probably. So. Okay, and always important to test the connection is really okay. Good continuity, it's going from this pin to that pin, and it's going from this pin to that pin. And it's not making contact there, so I have to. It's easier to do it on our microscope, but it's a little bit harder with the camera because my camera is mounted on the arm of my microscope. Okay, now it will be enough. I'll just clean it up a bit. So I better can see if there is if the connections are okay. This is a PCB cleaner, that's a sort of alcohol. Sort of alcohol, it is alcohol, but not like IPA, not almost 100%. There's also some water still in it, and they say that it's better to clean it up. The guy from Ben from Applied Science has a video about cleaning stuff and what is better to use in what circumstances. Can be better, and this is now okay. This looks good, that looks good. And I think this now, yep, and that way also. So that's good. So now the next step will be the transformer and connect some wires to it so we can do some testing. So I hooked it up. This is a little board I use for that. It has all sorts of connectors. Can connect the probe to it, etc. The power supply is not loaded at this moment. I have soldered two wires to the top, and they go to a main central I use for that. And the other end of that is connected to my isolation transformer, and there is at this moment a light bulb in series with it for in case it goes wrong. It's better to do this with an AC power supply if you have one, and test it, and you can just feed in the low AC on the secondary side. But let's look what it is doing. I will now turn on the power, and we have 13.6 volts regulated on the output but unloaded, so it should be 13.8, so I think this is okay. I will do a little test while loading it first, and after that I can close the box again.